Hello there, this is Bea, and welcome back to Biology. Today we're going to discuss one of the most important aspects of biology, or any science for that matter, the scientific method. This is simply an organized way of answering questions and solving problems. It may sound simple, but there is so much we can do with it. In fact, I'm wondering if it could help me get rich. You see, I've been playing around with my chemistry set, and I think I got a pretty good plant fertilizer developed. Can science help me prove that it's the best fertilizer in the world, so everyone wants to buy it? Well, let's back up from this excitement for a moment and go over what we are going to cover today. Our learning goal is that by the end of the lesson, you'll be able to explain the importance of the steps in the scientific method and give examples of good experimental design. What's on today's agenda? We will look at the following steps of the scientific method: make an observation, decide on a scientific question, develop a hypothesis to predict the answer to that question, and discuss good experimental design to test our hypothesis. Science usually starts with an observation. That's how we get information from the world around us. We use our senses to see, hear, feel, smell, and taste. Okay, very rarely do we get to taste anything in biology, but you never know, it could happen. My observation is that my houseplants are dying and sad. Now, like most humans, I'm naturally curious. If I make an observation like, my plants are dying and sad, I immediately start thinking of questions. What's wrong with them? Is there any way to help? Do they have enough water or too much? Are they getting enough sunlight? Are they annoyed with the music I've been playing for them? Could the new fertilizer I invented help them? Before I try to apply the scientific method, I need to decide if I have a scientific question. To be a scientific question, it must be answerable and testable. It cannot be based on opinion or be too open-ended. A good related scientific question for my observation might be, if I give my plants the new fertilizer, will they grow taller? Or maybe I don't care how tall they grow, I just want them to survive. I could ask, if I give my plants the new fertilizer, will they live longer? Both of these questions meet our requirements. They are answerable and testable, so I can use science to answer them. Stop the video for a moment and think of one other scientific question. If I give my plants the new fertilizer, write down your idea in the PDF. What kinds of questions can I not ask? What if I asked, will the new fertilizer make my plants prettier? That's based on opinion, not scientific. What about, will this be the best fertilizer in the world? Too open-ended, and also based on opinion. I probably shouldn't ask if it will make me rich. That's not seeming very scientific either. So we'll stick with one of our first ideas. Once I have a question, I can make a hypothesis. A hypothesis is a predicted answer to our question. It gives us a way to structure our experiment, because now we can focus on deciding whether our hypothesis was accurate or not. And by the way, it's completely fine if your hypothesis is inaccurate. This isn't a graded question. We just want to learn as much as we can about our topic of interest. And we can learn just as much from a hypothesis that was wrong as from one that was right. But if we haven't done the experiment yet, how do we know what a good hypothesis is? Well, in many cases, we already have some background knowledge of our subject matter. I've grown plants enough to know that fertilizer is generally a good thing for them. So a reasonable hypothesis here would be, if I give my plants the new fertilizer, then they will grow taller than the plants without fertilizer. It is common to write a hypothesis as an if-then statement, but it doesn't always have to be presented this way. If my question is on a topic that I don't know much about, I should probably do a bit of research first to get an idea of what a reasonable hypothesis would be. Now, you might be thinking, the word hypothesis seems awfully long and hard to say. Isn't that just the same thing as a theory? I hear people say, I have a theory, all the time, and it seems like it would be the same thing as a hypothesis, so can't I use that word instead? What do you think? It turns out, no. This is one of those cases where the language we use in everyday conversation is not the same language that we need to use in science. In science, a theory means something very different. Have you ever heard of the theory of evolution? Or what about the theory of gravity? It's basically everything we know about gravity. All the experiments that have been done, papers that have been written, mathematical formulas derived, and so on. That sounds very different from one little experiment about my houseplants. A theory is a broad explanation for a natural phenomenon with large amounts of supporting evidence. We'll talk about some theories in this class, but this isn't one of them. The experimental design, which means how the test is set up. So, we have a good hypothesis. Now it's time to test it. This is the most exciting part. But before I jump in, I need to make a plan. The results of my experiment will only be as good as my experimental design. There is a lot to know about good experimental design, but we'll cover some of the basics today. The first thing I should do is define my variables. The independent variable is the part of the experiment that we are manipulating so that we can study its effects. It's called independent because it is not influenced by any other variables. We directly and intentionally choose what value we want for it. In this case, it's the presence or absence of fertilizer. I could also test different strengths or types of fertilizers, but we'll keep our experiment very simple for now. Either the plants get fertilizer or they don't. The other variable I need to be aware of is my dependent variable. It depends on the independent variable, or at least we are wondering if it might, and it is whatever is being measured as the outcome of the experiment. In our case, it will be the height of the plants. Of course, we could measure other dependent variables, the color of the leaves, how long the plant lives, whether it produces flowers, the list goes on and on. Any of these might depend on whether the plant had fertilizer, but to keep it simple today, we'll just focus on the height. Only the fertilizer, my independent variable, can be changed directly. If anything else is changed, if they get different amounts of sunlight or a different type of soil, amount of water, type of pot, anything at all, then our results won't be valid because we won't know for sure which difference had an effect on the plant's growth. Was it the fertilizer? Well, if some of the plants got more water, maybe that's what made them grow taller. So we can only change one variable at a time, and that's our independent variable. Remember that the dependent variable may naturally change as a result of the independent variable, and that's okay. Another important part of the experimental design is to make a control group. The control group is a group of test subjects, which in our case are houseplants, that does not get the special treatment or fertilizer. I know, it seems so unfair to doom these plants to a sad, dying fate, but we need a group that we can compare to. If we give all of the plants fertilizer and they all grow really well, then we can't show that the fertilizer made any difference. Maybe they would have grown just as well without it. But if we have a control group which doesn't get fertilizer and an experimental group that does, and the experimental group grows way taller than the control group, bingo, we've got ourselves a winner! Of course, things could go horribly wrong, and maybe the experimental group does not like the fertilizer, and the control group actually does better. Or maybe there's no difference. Either way, we need to be able to make the comparison to know for sure. One more important part of our setup that we'll need to plan carefully is our number of trials. If I give one plant the fertilizer and one plant gets none, and I watch them grow, no matter what happens, my results are not going to be very impressive. One plant doesn't prove anything. Two plants doesn't prove much more. Ideally, I want to set up multiple repeated trials and hope that I get similar results in each trial. This suggests that I set up my experiment well and that my data is valid and reliable. Let's make each group, control and experimental, have 10 identical plants. If all 10 plants in each group grow similarly to the others in their group, then we can probably count on our results being trustworthy. The last thing we need to consider in our experimental design is how to minimize bias. You may have heard the word bias before. Do you know what it means? It's anything that could possibly skew our results. Well, gosh, the first possibility of bias here might actually be me. I have a vested interest in the outcome of this experiment. I'm still hoping to get rich from my fertilizer, so I really want these results to show that it works very well. Can I possibly resist the temptation to slip a few extra sips of water to the experimental group? Or put them a little closer to the window? It would be so easy. No one would know, right? Yikes! That's not good science. I better hand this whole process over to a friend. Even if I don't do it intentionally, there's a chance that my bias here will affect how the test subjects are treated. I'll make sure my friend knows what to do, but I better let a neutral third party be in charge of the execution so that we know it's fair. Otherwise, I think our experimental design is set. We are well on our way to having good data to analyze. Now we are ready to review and talk about next steps. Let's review what we did today. We came up with a good scientific question that was testable. Will my plants grow taller if I give them the new fertilizer? Then we made a prediction, or hypothesis, to go along with it. We hypothesized that the plants would grow taller if they were given the new fertilizer. We looked at aspects of experimental design that will ensure our experiment gives us good results, like defining independent and dependent variables, making a control group, setting up multiple trials, and avoiding bias. So, our experiment is all set up. The identical plants all tucked into their cozy little identical pots. They are getting the same amount of water, they have the same soil, and a completely objective person is in charge of watching them grow. Now we just have to wait for the results. Tune in next time to find out if I am on my way to being rich. Oh wait, that wasn't our question. Tune in next time to find out if the plants that were given fertilizer grew taller than the plants without. I'm still hoping to get rich though. Until next time, remember, biology isn't just science. It's the way of life.